not taking any crap and not forgetting that they ruined his bedtime story, his bedtime ritual where he expected to see carnage. He's like, if I don't get in a bedtime story, I'll create one myself. Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, welcome or welcome back to Soap Lore, the official gathering place for newbies, novices, and OG diehard fans of the golden age of prime time. I'm your host, Jed, viewing and reviewing the Sophia Sophia's prime time storyline of 1984. We're still on the West Coast doing the absolute most with the Channing Giroverti clan on season 4, episode 12. So whether you're new to this or true to this, sit back and enjoy. Tell the kids it's time to play outside or out of sight. Don't leave no questions, suggestions, or concerns for the next 25 or 35 minutes. Everyone else in the earshot, pool, quiet, or kicked out, are your only options, so choose wisely because we are watching our stories. Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, this is Soap Lore. Welcome or welcome back to Soap Lore. I have no idea why I decided to hello. I'm not Adele, I'm your girl Jet. The Sophia's primetime soap operas of a go. I hope this is a great day for you. I ain't gonna lie, I'm having a good time. I took vacation. Actually, I was supposed to go to a concert. Unfortunately, it was canceled. So I decided to keep my vacation. And I'll tell you what, sometimes I feel like being domestic. Sometimes I just want to fold a little laundry. Sometimes. Every now and again. It just feels good to catch up. I bought some exciting new Gain Scents. I use the Downy. I know it's got chemicals and stuff, but whatever. I don't really care. It smells amazing. And this is how I know I am a grown woman. I'm getting excited over things that I really shouldn't be that pumped over, but I love the whole scent burst things in my laundry. They're so good. It's not as glamorous, but hey, that's why we watch soap operas now, isn't it? Actually, one of my coworkers, I was in my office and he comes through like the back door, the back of the office, and I keep smelling like fresh, clean cotton. I'm like, oh my God, something smells so good. I'm thinking it's a candle. I thought he sprayed something. He's like, no, this is some laundry detergent my sisters got me for Christmas. I usually only save it for like special occasions. Like if he's thinking if he goes to a wedding or a funeral, like he washes his clothes with the good stuff. But he's like, I just happened to run out of the other stuff, so I had to use this today. It is delightful. I looked up the price. Tell me why it's $89. Are you kidding me? For laundry soap? It's a little thing sometimes, right? Sometimes it's a big thing. Sometimes it's inheriting or winning or paying for a third of someone else's property just to piss them off. And that's exactly where we pick up on Soap Floor today. I'm sure all of their laundry smells as exquisite as my coworkers, because if nothing else, I learned on this episode, don't ever forget that Falcon Crest is sexy. From top to bottom, everybody on the show. And the opening sequence tells us just that. So go ahead and pour yourself up something bubbly. Stop doing your chores, or if you insist. I'll talk long enough to get you through your laundry, but that's it. I don't do bathrooms. I am tripping today, y'all. I'm in a good mood. God, it feels good. But stay tuned for season 4. Episode 12 of Falcon Crest, Triumvirate. I also have to beg your pardon. You're going to hear my laundry spin cycle in the background for a little bit from time to time. It is what it is. I actually have a little bit more to do than I realized. I like to scrub-a-dub-dub right before bigger holidays at the time of this recording. It's after Thanksgiving, before Christmas. I know things are about to get hectic. So I just want to have a stockpile of extra fresh stuff so that nobody gets amnesia as to where their clean clothes are. You know how that goes. All right. Triumvirate. I hope I'm saying that right. I actually had to look up this world. If nothing else, Falcon Crest knows how to come up with a good title. They keep me looking up things in the dictionary. I'm like, what the heck does that mean? Yes, triumvirate. If you're familiar with this word, great. Apparently it's a group of three men holding power, in particular the first triumvirate, the unofficial coalition of Julius Caesar, Pompey, blah, 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 the Second Triumvirate, a coalition formed by Antony, Octavian, and someone else in 43 BC. Okay, it is a three-way for power. Very interesting. Of course, we know that this is not what anyone, well, it's not what anyone from the Gioberti bloodline actually wanted, but it's what they got. And it's actually kind of what they deserve. Just to bring you up to speed in case you missed the last episode. Francesca, the gorgeous cousin from Italy, has shown up. She figured out that her family is not really much of a family here in the States. She's disgusted by them, but she still needs money. So that the Gioberti's in France, in Italy can save their vineyard. They had a horrible season where like these moths ate up their crops. So they basically have to start from scratch. It's not a situation where she can just hope it'll be better next season. They're starting over and they're going to need something to tide them over until they can get going. Through a series of events, she knows that she is Angela Channing's sister, which means she is entitled to part of Falcon Crest. She don't really want it, but she just wants the money. She thinks she's doing good. Figures out that she's dealing with a bunch of vultures and decides she's going to work this out in the courts. She has everyone bid for her third of the property and decides on a whim she's going to give it to her main squeeze, her little lover, homie lover friend on the West Coast, Richard Channing. Now, technically, Richard is family. Richard is the love child between Chase Gioberti's mom and Angela Channing's husband. So no, he's not blood related to Angela, but he is to Chase. Just not in the Gioberti way. Which is interesting because not only does he not know anything about wine, he doesn't drink. He only drinks milk on every single episode. But this episode, he's forced to at least taste wine. It's not really his thing. Spoiler alert. But what he does like is a taste of business, of possibility. He's a prospecting young man, as they say. Brilliant indeed. So this episode picks up immediately after the announcement that he has won the bid for Francesca's third of Falcon Crest, even though he brought the smallest amount of shmoney. So Richard leaves the house. He walks Francesca to her limo and they chow. She gets in her little car and she goes to the airport. Well, his limo pulls up, but he turns around because of course he needs to stunt a little bit. So he turns around and the entire family has walked out on the porch and everybody is dressed to the nines because they can, because they will, because that's what they do. But they're kind of flanked around Angela in one of the best, oh my God, moments I've seen on the show. And there's no like vileness. There's no violence. It's just stone cold, sexy. Everybody is gorgeous and they need you to know it. You know what it feels like? It feels like I'm watching Zoolander a little bit. So Angela's in the middle, flanked by Chase and Maggie. So on her left, it's Maggie in the back, Cole with his hands on his hip, Melissa staring over her shoulder. And then on the other side, it is Chase in the back. Chase is wearing shades. He's wearing the aviators. He's got his hands on his hip. Lance has got one arm on the post, the other hand on his hip. Emma is standing kind of with her shoulders out and they're all doing blue steel. Like, everybody be sexy. I can almost hear the director say, okay. Ladies, suck it in or poke it out. Fellas, bite down. We need to see those jaw lines. That's right. Chase, show us your chest. Give us aviator. Give us stern. Give us flying eagle. Perfect. Lance. Oh, God. Does anybody have any baby oil for a long time? For Lorenzo? Okay, fine. Lance, throw a hand up. Shades out. Give the women what they want. That's right. Emma, play coy. Melissa, sexier. Maggie, chin up. You're rich. You're mama. You're MILF. Hot. It's just so... I love it. It was like, oh, they're pretty. They need, if nothing else, y'all need to take a picture. Somebody take a picture. And Richard even says as much when he turns around. He's like, oh, what a good looking group. And he puts his hands out like he's a director. Like, ah, I want to remember this family picture just like this. Growling at him. Angela looks gorgeous in the middle too. He's like, I won't let you get away with this. We'll be back in court before you know. And he's like, that's great. Bye, losers. Considering all the changes going on, I would say that Angela is taking the news in stride. She's doing her best to accept it. Not really. You know, she's working triple and double time to figure out how to get everything back to normal, back to the time where it was all about her. She was this vineyard. It was her birthright. But now she's got all these relatives showing up. Now she's got her husband's bastard. He has a third of what is rightfully hers? Absolutely not. She's also entered her paranoid era, as we learn over dinner when it's just she and Emma. This is the most naked I've seen their dining room table. So maybe it was lunch. You know, they're dressed so finely, I couldn't hardly tell. But they're sitting at the table, Emma and Angie, and they're trying to figure out, looking at how did all this come about? I'm trying to figure out who came in here and stole this. The documents, I'm just like, who would betray us? So Emma's sitting there, she's like, you think it was Charlie? And she's like, nah, he's family. Family to Angela means anybody who is just like me. He's her do-dirt dude, he's her ace. There's no way, and he definitely didn't do it. No one at this point is on to Lieberman as LeBlanc or whatever his name is. But then Angela's sitting there eating her food and she starts looking at Emma like, wait a minute, why are you so nervous? Why are you all fidgety and stuff? It's making me uncomfortable. Emma is totally giving herself away. Like, maybe she didn't tell that. She definitely told something. But she's like, I would never. She goes to the other end of the table to eat. I wouldn't say that Angie is a bit player this episode, but it isn't really about her very much. She's in her paranoid era. She's trying to figure out how this all came to be. And she's got to get to the bottom of Melissa being her heir. That was a huge mistake. That ship has sailed. She needs to make sure that goes as planned. So she reaches out to Manimal. She told him last episode, figure it out. He comes in this episode and he's like, look, I got a solution. I don't know how much you're going to like it. She's like, shoot, what you got? He tells her that he can basically not necessarily remove Melissa, but he can make it to where she'd barely get anything so long as the trust is set up in Lance's name. So Lance would get like 99% of it and Melissa would get the little shillings. Angela thinks it over just really briefly. She's like, God, that's drastic, but hey, I can live with that. Absolutely. God, I wish I liked that kid. He says something a little slick to her later on in the episode. Like, God, I wish I liked him. You know she loves him. That's her boy. That was going to be her heir anyway. So she's like, I don't really care. As long as that girl doesn't get it, we're good. Let's move on. Now, bad girl Melly is very, very interesting in this episode. She's all over town doing all the things. So she goes bursting into Lance's office with a silver, a tray with a silver platter. You know how these people love silver. And a guy pushing the stuff in. She's not actually pushing the tray in herself, but she comes in and she's like, hey, Lance, guess what? Our divorce went through today and they're on good terms. They're both kind of chuckling like, ah, ha, ha. She's like, well, I bought champagne and pie. I figure we had wedding cake. We can have a divorce pie. So they pull up the champagne and they start drinking it. And he's like, we're nuts. We're crazy. And they kind of laugh at ah, ka, 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 ka. You want some pie? Yeah, I'll take some pie. Now, we're going to be delicate the rest of this topic. They start looking at the pie and it's almost as if Lance is looking at Melissa's piece of pie. Like, man, I used to have that. It was delicious. She's looking at Lance's piece of pie. Like, man, I used to have his pie all the time. It's delicious. They decide they're going to have pie right then and there. If you know what I'm saying. They have a little pie right there on his desk. So then she goes home to play Mommy Dearest. Now, I'm not judging this girl. She's a bad girl. She's a bad girl on primetime soap opera. She's absolutely going to be doing the most. So she goes home and she's spending time with my favorite person on this show, Baby Joseph. He's sitting in between his parents and they're supposed to be reading him this story. But Melissa's still a little bit green when it comes to parenting and she doesn't really read the room. So it's like, once upon a time, the princess went up to the castle and then she goes, and the princess said, my divorce was final today. And Baby Joseph, you know, he's a grown man in a little kid's body. He's had an whole accounting career. He's looking at the words like, wait, no, that's mother. That's not quite right. No, that's not it. And Cole jumps in. He's like, no, this is a new story. And the prince said, will you marry me? And then she's like, and the princess says, yes. And Joseph's still looking at the book like, okay, cool. I can respect the creative liberties you're taking. However, I really need to, I've been thinking about this book all day. Can we get back to the story? So they're making out all above his head. And Joseph says what all of us are thinking. He's like, when is the dragon gonna eat these people? Can you imagine a little two-year-old who's been playing with toy trucks and all that all day? And he's like, I need a little carnage right before bed. It helps me sleep. I don't know why. Maybe it's the Angela Channing blood running through my veins. I just need a little bit of violence in this story. They ruin bedtime in not so many words. And baby Joseph is petty. So he bides his time, he bites his tongue, and at the right time, he's going to deliver this blow to the entire family. Just like Angela, she's not going to tell anybody that Melissa's at will just yet. She wants to wait for the perfect time when Melissa goes broke. She's a kick you when you're down kind of lady. So we got to talk about Julia really quick. The long and short of it is that Spheres has developed a little bit of a crush. She somehow managed to allow the doctors, or the doctors allowed her to go take a shower. So she's like brushing her hair, freshening up, washing the day off of her in front of that two-way mirror that she doesn't realize is a two-way mirror. The doctor comes in and he tells her, oh, hey, your mom wants you to have a lobotomy, so we're going to go ahead and schedule that. She's like, a lobotomy? They don't even do that anymore. Highly illegal, I'm assuming, by this point in history, but the doctor's like, well, yeah, I mean, but some of us still believe in it, so we're going to need to do one on you. He then closes the door and she's left holding a comb and a mascara wand. And I'm thinking, this girl has been in prison. She's been in the loony bin. She's been fighting people off of her left and right for the last 2 or 3 years. Do you really think that doctor would stand a chance of folding her back into that bed? But somehow, some way, next time we see Julia, she's strapped back to that bed. I'm like, how did this happen? Well, the doctor injects her with something and she starts to get super drowsy. Right then, Lieberman comes bursting through. Unhand her, unhand her. I will not stand for this. I will not have this woman disrespected, blah, blah, blah. And the doctor's like, oh no, you're just a psychiatrist. You can't come in here and say these things to me, a real doctor, not a fake one. And the nurse is like, I'm a nurse. No, please. Spheres is there as well. So Lieberman's all, unhand her. I am a doctor. Unhand her. I won't have this. Mind if she is spiraling deeper and deeper into whatever dope they hopped her up, until the point where she passes out. Lieberman raises her eyes just to kind of like, he opens them to see, to make sure she's knocked out. And he's like, okay, great. That went well, everybody. Let's go have a little lunch. They leave the room. Will she remember this? I don't think so. She seems like she was totally out of it. So I'm sure she'll wake up from some fuzzy dream and he'll be her knight in shining armor. But I don't know why they needed to drug her for that. Maybe he hadn't really worked it out any further than that. But either way, she's doped up and is not going to have a lobotomy. But I'm sure her fate is much, much worse. Speaking of being doped up, Florida man breaks into Terry's house one more again. He's so good at it at this point. She might as well just give him a key. You know he's coming. You know what he wants. He's not going to rough you up if you give him money. Just leave $5,000 downstairs in a mousetrap or something and get rid of the guy. But she refuses. So he comes in. But this time, there's something about his demeanor that freaks her out. She can tell that he's not well. Please, I mean, we could really get married. We could really do this. And she's like, honey, I used to love you when you were you. You're not you anymore. I don't love this version of you. It sucks. He's like, okay, but can I have something to drink? Please give me something, some Pepsi or something. And she's like, okay, fine. She's going to go downstairs, but her purse is on the bed. And she's like, nah, fool me once, fool me twice. She grabs her purse and she goes downstairs. And he's okay for a little, but he's still like writhing around. But then he starts to think clearly. I'm like, I need money and I need money fast. So he starts looking around her bedroom, goes over to her top drawer and starts moving all her underwear around. And he finds a box. A fancy box, like the Julia Roberts box from Pretty Woman. And he opens it, and sure enough, there's a super Zsa Zsa necklace. He takes it, and he jumps out of the window. She comes up right after that. She's looking for him under the bed, in the bathroom. And then she notices that her drawer has been disrespected. She goes over, sees a note that Michael had written to her about her being beautiful. I'm like, whatever. They did not have a freaking love affair. Why are we doing this? Why are we doing this? It is what it is. So now she knows the necklace is missing. Luckily for her, Richard Channing has been keeping an eye on this situation. He had Pam, his do dirt lady, dig into Terry's past. He knows that she was a full-on hooker. He knows that her ex-man was hooked on that coke. He knows that they're still married. So he tells Pam, I don't care how much it costs. I want you to finalize that divorce. Because it seems like what Terry did is she filed for the divorce. She did everything she needed to, but it just never went through. I don't know if he's, they don't get into that. So Richard's like, just make sure it's done. Make sure it's done. Make sure I have some paperwork to present to her so that I can get her over on my side. So once all this is done, Richard calls a meeting with Aunt Terry. Aunt Terry sits in with them. He's like, I can help you with your little problem. I know you're married, but let me show you a little something. He showed her the papers. I just need a little favor from you. Now she's ready to get down. Some old habits die hard. She's thinking he wants to have pie, just like Melissa and Lance had pie. No, he don't want pie. He wants grapes. She said, grapes? Yeah, I want your harvest. Oh, yeah, okay. That seems fair. I mean, that's easy money. Are you sure that's all you want? He goes, yeah. What do you think? She goes, oh, I thought you were trying to have some pie. He's, oh, I'm really flattered, but no, I'm good. I don't want any pie. I just want your grapes. She's like, well, hell, it's the easiest money I've ever made in my life. Absolutely, Richard. Congratulations on my new grapes. A surprising addition to the grape and pie talk this week is none other than the manimal and our girl Pam. I suppose we got to have these expats get together somehow. So the scene was amazing. So Joel is working at a gas station, or I don't know where this gas comes from. Maybe there's just two sort of loose leaf gas pumps on the property. But if you look at it objectively, you'll notice that they're in front of a garage, like the garage of someone's house. And there are two pumps side by side. Anyone who's ever been to a gas station, at least in the U.S., you know there's usually a little space in between them. Even the old-fashioned ones, you have like the gas pump, and then there's usually like a space, some trash cans, and then the other one. These two are side by side, like someone drug them out to the curb and they want either the garbage man to pick them up or they're gonna sell them. So Joel is standing right there, and Pam drives up in her little two-seater, and she's kind of enjoying the eye candy. She's looking him up and down, up and down. He's enjoying being admired. And he asks her if he can clean her windows while her petrol pumps. And he's like, sure. And I guess him using the word petrol tickles her ears a little bit. She goes, hey, so did you spend a little time in England? He's like, yeah, I was a race car driver over there. It was super exciting, swinging lifestyle. They're flirting or whatever. And then the manimal shows up. I guess he needs gas too, but he's pumped. He's on the other side of her. So she walks over. They have a quick little conversation about, oh my gosh, where's your boss? Where's your boss? Is your name Andrew? Yeah, it's Andrew. Why don't you come over to my house? Why don't I come over to your house? I don't know if this annoys Florida man, but for no reason, he just kind of honks her horn to get her attention. Hey, your gas is done and your windows are clean. So why don't you come over and get back in your car? She's like, bet. The manimal's like, well, come to my house. Sure. So she goes home, wherever home is now. She gets dressed in a cute little cocktail dress. She goes to the manimal's house. Try as I might, I think I watched this scene twice or tried to watch it twice. It just wasn't interesting. I don't know what they're talking about. I think his middle name is Andrew. Maybe he went by Andrew at one point. I'm assuming since they're both from England, even though England's a whole country, they could be from two totally different sides. Maybe, I don't know. Whatever. Dancing. There's candlelight. There's champagne made from the finest grapes. He is wooing her. Now, this shouldn't be surprising to me, but it is. You see, Craig Reardon is quite gorgeous. He is no doubt the blueprint for countless Disney princes of ago and of the future. However, there is just something about his demeanor that immediately turns you off. I don't know what it is. Because on paper, he's gorgeous. He's perfection, but it just doesn't translate. Somehow he seduces her. Maybe she's just on the rebound. Next thing you know, they're lying in the middle of the floor. Mind you, he has a tile floor, okay? Tile floor. They made a pillow fort, a blanket fort. They land on the ground eating pie. You know what I'm saying? Making love on terracotta floors. It's incredible.
Throw that out.
Later on in the episode, at that same quote-unquote gas station, wink, wink, Lance decides he needs a fill up too. So Joel is wiping his car in all the wrong places to me. Like, I don't understand what he's doing. He's wiping the car. Him and Lance are talking about it. And Lance's like, yeah, bro, this is my blah, blah, blah car. It's super fast. And Florida man's on. Yeah, bro. I used to race stock cars. It's so much fun. I bet I could take you. And Lance is like, you think so? Yeah. You just want to see her? You just like want to bet on it? Florida man Joel is like, yeah, let's bet. $5,000, winner takes all. And Lance is like, yeah, nobody can beat my car for sure. But they're not like angry at each other. Just decide, two bros decide they're going to do this. So you know where the $5,000 is coming from. We already know. Just go ahead and call Terry. Stop breaking in her house. But Lance gets in his car. And I forget what Joel says. So we're looking at, like, Lance is looking at the audience head on. And Joel kind of unsmoothly wipes the door of Lance's car. And he's like, yeah, I'll see you real soon. I'll get with you with the details. And Lance says, and I quote, yo. Let me repeat that for y'all. Yo. And then he drives off with his glasses on. Was that cool circa 1984? Somebody please tell me. Text me and tell me. It reminded me of, you remember on Grease when he goes, he was like peacocking. No, it wasn't her. It was it him or was it Rizzo? She was like making fun of a dude, but she's like, oh yo, look. Was really, really weird. Ew. All right, Lance. Lucky you're cute. And I'm not going to act like I didn't enjoy the scene because they're both really cute. But we got to get to the getting. So two more things really quickly before the big finale. Chase is in the wine house. You know, the wine house is damn near cursed at this point. There's always something going on there. So he's up on one of the rafters and he hears Chase. And you know, it's a little bit creepy. Well, he's looking around. He comes down on the floor. You can hear his little church shoes. Click, clock, click. Come on out. Show yourself. Oh, come on, Chase. Somebody's like taunting him. He's like, what the F? You can tell he's freaking out, but he's trying to keep it cool. Well, finally, some weirdo jumps out of the shadows out from one of the big old barrels. And he's like, Chase, it's finally time. You're going to meet your maker. So Chase puts up his dukes. You can tell he's still scared. And the guy says, the guy kind of lifts his hat. And he's like, I'll be damned. Ben, is that you? And they, they start hugging each other. And that's his homeboy from NOM. They were pilots together. Ben's a stand-up guy, but he plays too much. Like, Ben, you play way too much. He didn't know that Chase's dad died right there in that same spot. Well, Ben is in town because he's not necessarily with the military. He implies that he's maybe with the CIA or the FBI or something. And he's like, dude, there's some weird stuff going on here. This valley is mad creepy. I already know about your mom. I already know about this Lieberman dude. I think Lieberman's here. It's either him or like he had a son maybe. And Chase is listening to this because Ben is a little bit paranoid. Ben's always been like that. He's always worried about the Russians listening, blah, blah, blah. And Chase is like, man, are you sure? He's like, well, I mean, it's not out of the ordinary. Wasn't your mom like a Nazi sympathizer? Didn't she run a cartel and your brother in the cartel? He's like, I mean, you're making sense. What you're saying, these are accurate terms. Yes. Yes. He's like, well, you need to go home because I bet they have this whole place bugged. You should check everything. Sure enough, Chase goes home and he's having a full on conversation with Maggie. Ooh, baby. I love you, baby. He waits till after the conversation. Screws the bottom part of his phone. And of course he fishes out a bug. He's like, well, hell, Ben was right. Or I think he calls Ben. And he's like, dude, you were right. My phone was bugged, but it's not bugged now. What do we do? He goes, well, listen, I think I have an idea. I'm going to go check out something. Do you want to come with me? And Chase is like, yeah, I'll go with you. Well, it turns out he goes to Richard's house. Now, Chase can't very well walk into Richard's house because Richard knows him. Ben has somehow managed to get a van, and he's disguised as like the cable company. He ruined the kid's cable so that Richard would call, and now he's going to come out there and quote unquote fix. Very, very small piece of this episode. Lorraine, Richard's stepdaughter, gets drunk, gets all hot and bothered. She wants some pie with Lance. She calls him and asks if he wants to come over and have pie, and he's like, bet. But then when he gets there, she wants to have the pie in Richard's room. And he's like, I can't take advantage of this delicious pie here in this room. So wait till you have a little more coffee. And if you still want to have pie, I'm happy to do it. I just can't do it now. Not in his house. Ben and Chase end up sneaking in the house. And they almost get caught by Lance as he's leaving. And this is like news to Chase. Chase just, this is what gets me. He just doesn't know anything. It's not that these things are super secret. If you pay attention, you might know these things. He didn't know that Lance was after Lorraine. So he's like, dang, if my brother finds out this kid was in his house, he's going to flip. But then he can't very well tell him, because then you have to tell him he snuck in his house. They go in and they plant a bug on Richard's lamp. The very best part of this episode is Maggie. So Maggie is at the radio station. I forgot she's going to be like a radio reporter. So I thought she was about to sing us a song. And in my mind, maybe because Ben was already there, I was just thinking, my mind hears the name Ben. And the millennial in me thinks Ben Savage from Boy Meets World. But then I think his brother was so much cuter to me. I really like the other one, the one from Wonder Years, whose name escapes me at the moment. Kevin Arnold. He was so cute. But then I remember that movie that he did with DJ Tanner, aka Candace, whatever her name is, where he was like an abusive boyfriend. And then it makes me think of how much I miss TV movies. And then I'm like, yo, I'm supposed to be thinking about Ben. So I go back to Ben Savage. Ben and Fred Savage, that's his name. And then I think of another TV movie, the Jackson 5 movie, The American Dream. And then the two of us need look no more. I'm not a singer, forgive me, but that song has been stuck in my head all day now. So, Richard and Maggie. Maggie is not in the booth about to break down in a rendition of Michael Jackson or the Jackson 5's Ben. She is going to read the evening news, but there's a special guest. Lorraine knows this lady is here, the PI that has been hired by both Maggie and Angela, unbeknownst to Maggie, comes in with this lovely older woman. Lorraine sees her. She runs to Richard's office. She's like, hey, you need to come out. I think Mag's mom is here. He's super excited for her. You know, they're friends again. So he runs out to see, and Maggie is none the wiser. She is a professional. She has a golden voice. When they isolate her, I'm like, God, I would love to hear a book that she reads. I'll have to look her up and see if she has any. But she starts to read the news, and she locks eyes with her mother. And it's like, oh my God, it's so sweet. So mommy comes out. They hug. She's like, Charlotte, she's so lovely. Charlotte's story is not that unusual for back in the day, circa the 40s, 30s, 50s, a lot of young mothers. I watched that show on TLC where they reunite people with long lost family. I think it's called Long Lost Family. So this is not uncommon. It seems like from 20s, 30s, and 40s, 50s, and 60s, it was not unusual for women to have babies as teenagers. I guess it wouldn't be women, there'd be kids, would have a baby and your parents would take the kid and put him away. Very, very, very common. So that's kind of Maggie's story. Her mom fell in love with her dad. He was a GI. She was like performing. She was a performer. And she was only 19. They fell in love. You know, they had pie. And then she became pregnant with Maggie. But unfortunately, he didn't come back from the South Pacific. When her family found out, they disowned her. They were so ashamed. She had to get rid of the baby. And she just has all this shame for all those years. They notice they have some of the same mannerisms. It's really sweet. So Maggie does what any good daughter or good neighbor would do. She invites her mom over for dinner. Melissa's there. Cole's there. Chase is there, of course. Maggie and her mom are sitting side by side. And baby Joseph wasn't at dinner, but this is his time to shine. Not taking any crap and not forgetting that they ruined his bedtime story, his bedtime ritual where he expected to see carnage. He's like, if I don't get in a bedtime story, I'll create one myself. So out of nowhere, he's like, yeah, I'm going to bed. Or the nurse, not nurse, the maid comes in with him. She goes, this little guy's off to bed. And he announces very clearly and very loudly for a three-year-old, Mommy and Daddy are getting married. That was the quote-unquote story last night. Good night, losers. Okay, I might have taken a couple creative liberties there, but you get the gist. He outs them. And they're like, okay, yeah, go to bed. Chase looks like, oh my God, are you really? Oh my God, really? And this is all very embarrassing in front of the new grandma. But she plays it off. She's like, oh my God, that's, I mean, it's cool. Your mom kind of told me. What she didn't say is, your mom told me how trifling this little heifer is and it's sitting next to you. I understand she tried to have another man's baby. She got married when she had Joe baby. I understand she's trifling, but love conquers all. Love has a way of finding us. Chase is not pleased. And that's only going to get worse because the next and final scene is Richard calling a meeting as the new third owner of Falcon Crest. He wants everybody to meet in the little tasting room. He has something to say. So everyone, and I do mean everyone except Joel, shows up. I hate meetings. I'm just going to say it. I'm not a fan. Anyone who works in corporate America, you know what it is. Like, it doesn't matter where you work, actually. Having a meeting, the purpose is to accomplish something. I don't always find that that's the thing. Richard's meetings are my dreams. When I tell you they were in and out of there in 4 minutes. So Richard has everyone sit down. He thanks them all for coming. He explains that he's got a little bit of a vision. He wants to mass produce their wine on the cheap. And in order to do that, he wants to utilize every available resource. One of those resources will pull them into the 21st century, and it is computer knowledge. He said, we can program this computer to give us all the dates on the what's ripe, what's not, blah, blah, blah. Basically, we can get this wine thing perfected, mass produced. Sounds like he's selling box wine is what I'm hearing. And yeah, it'll just take us into the next century. It'll make us a lot of money. That's it. That's all. Y'all sit and think about it. Lorraine's going to pass out some literature to you. There's a buffet and wine in the back if you're ready. And I'm like, a buffet and wine? No, a buffet and a bar, he said. Oh my God, this is my type of meeting. Angela is listening to all this with her eyes rolling as far back in her head as she can. Her and Chase are shit. You know, I love when people... That whole saying, my enemy's enemy is my friend. Well, they're both Richard's enemies. So now all of a sudden they're looking at each other like, do you hear this? Boy, do you hear this? But the piece de resistance is that he wants to name the new... he wants to name the new wine Francesca after the lovely lady who inspired him. That is all Angela can take. She rolls, oh my God, it's the best eye roll. She can't believe this shit. Who, are you serious right now, Richard? Falcon Grass is getting messy. Not only are they getting messy, we are adding people to the fold. We have Weirdo Ben showing up out of nowhere. Mommy Dearest, oh no, that wasn't the final scene. So the final scene is Angela talking to Craig Reardon about, she sees Maggie. Okay, so this is what I need to figure out. They weren't actually at the wine tasting room at the vineyard. They were at Richard's racetrack because Maggie's mom is like looking out longingly in the hallway. You can tell she's kind of stutter-stepping. She wants to go out there. Angela sees this and she's looking at Craig Reardon. She's like, you wanted to know why I was so keen on helping Maggie? This is exactly why. Her mother is an incurable gambler. Yuck, 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 yuck. She's setting this woman up. Now, why she has beef with these people, I don't know. I can't figure out for the life of me what would she gain from Maggie's mom being like a gambling addict. Apparently, her mother was in rehab to help herself. That's where they found her. So this was all a setup. Ooh, Falcon Crest is getting messy, messy, messy. Love the new edition. And we gotta figure out where Maggie's dad is now, because like, he's supposed to be digging up stuff. Then like, this Nazi story has to play out eventually. We're already on episode 12. There's not too many more. All right, guys, that's it. That's all. I have thoroughly enjoyed myself today. I hope you're having a wonderful morning, noon, or evening, whenever you're listening to this. And have some pie. Real pie or pie? It's up to you, baby. It's none of my business. Stay moisturized, stay hydrated, mind your own business, and keep all of your drama on TV.